who's a longtime friend and who has been providing, who has been kind enough to provide lectures at PIDS whenever he's in the Philippines. This morning he's going to share with us some insights from our review of some programs in China, and we're hoping that this would also provide us some learning in terms of how we can improve some of the poverty reduction programs that we're implementing in the Philippines. And so we welcome all of you, and we're looking forward to a very productive discussion this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, Celia, for your introduction. So I'm here again. I greatly enjoy coming to PIDS, and thanks to Celia that she makes it possible for me to visit here. Now, as you know that Celia has now become president of PIDS, a think tank of the government, and I think she has achieved the milestone of the historic proportion. She is the only woman president appointed to PIDS from the very beginning. So it's a great achievement, and she deserves this because she has made enormous contribution to development of CBMS, the community-based monitoring system. Actually, I call her mother of CBMS. She developed this program, and it has now been adopted by PEP, which is a very international network, and it has been widely accepted in Philippines, but all over the world, in African countries particularly, the message is going there also, and they are adopting this system. So she has made enormous contribution. I mean, the system has become a sort of grassroots system to reduce or alleviate poverty at the local level. So Celia, I salute you for your achievement. Okay, so let me now start. I was just in China. I came back about a week ago, week and a half ago from China. I was there for a month, but I visited 1 year before, same time, March. I spent 1 month before when I started working on this, and then I finalized this paper while I was visiting this time. I enjoyed going to China. It's very, very friendly place, and they, I worked with people there, and they provided me all the data and analysis and lot of discussion with Chinese scholars. So let me. Now, if we accept that reduction of absolute poverty is a meaningful goal, then I would say that China has indeed succeeded in achieving this goal. Based on the official poverty line in 1978, incidence of poverty in rural China reduced from 30.7% in 78 to only 1.6% in 2007. Now, official poverty line was revised upward in 2010 to yuan 2,300 per annum per person. Consequently, the poverty rate increased from 30% in 1978 to 97.5% in 2010 because they increased the poverty line. But even with the higher poverty line, the trend continued. The poverty reduction continued to decline, reaching only 5.7% in 2015. So So this is a total poverty in both rural and urban, but I will be focusing on rural poverty because rural poverty is more serious there than the urban poverty. Urban poverty is almost eliminated, you know, with this poverty line. But rural poverty line, poverty is around 10% at the moment. So it is important. I mean, China has provided leadership in reducing poverty. You know, the rate at which they have reduced poverty is enormous, you know. Even, you know, you must have, if you are following CNN, the Farid Zakaria, once he said that he covered, you know, he provides a very, very good analysis of the current issues. And one program, he covered the global poverty. And he says that about 700 million people have been lifted out of poverty in two or three decades, you know. And most of the credit of poverty reduction goes to China. Out of 700 million people lifted out of poverty, almost 400 to 500 million were from China, you know, happened in China. So it is important to understand why they have been able to reduce. So is it the economic growth, pattern of growth? You know, I will introduce the idea of pattern of growth. So I will cover, because I have only two periods, 2007 and 2013 data, because these are the comparable data sets. I could have gone back before that, but then comparability I would have lost. So I focus on these two periods. So I'm using this household income project survey, this CHIP, which was developed by Beijing Normal University in China. So idea is, I draw some policy conclusions, identifying which policies are pro-poor and which are not, and which policies can achieve a rapid reduction in poverty. So this is the presentation I will be giving. Now, am I going all right? Yes. Okay. Now, I've been working on a book going to be published by Edward Elgar, where my idea was to select about 40 internationally, 40 articles on economic growth and poverty reduction in top journals, and then provide a review of that. Then I was looking at what is economic growth. I mean, everybody talks about economic growth, but there is no consensus among the economists what is the definition of economic growth. Anyway, I will discuss that. But what I see, what economists mean by economic growth is that in an economy, the thousands of goods and services are produced in the economy, right? Every day, right? And millions of people are participating in the production of those goods and services. So, but how the total output which is produced in the economy, how it is distributed, who gets what? I mean, that's the question. I mean, they say, okay, the contribution they make to the production of the output, they are rewarded according to their contribution. I mean, this is a general, you know, thing that, but when economists talk about economic growth, they are only talking about the value of the total output in measured in monetary terms, you know, which is called GDP, gross domestic product. So they are focusing only on how, at what rate GDP is growing over a period of time. That is economic growth, what people discuss about. But they don't discuss how this economic growth is contributed by whom, you know, who's contributing to this economic growth, and how much rewards they are getting, or how much benefits they get from this economic growth. So that's what I'm saying, that we have to go into pattern of growth, not just focus on total growth, but we have to go into pattern of growth. So what happens is that every individual, according to their contribution or non-contribution, they get some entitlement to the output. You know, the total output which is produced, they get some entitlement to that, right? Depending on their contribution or depending on, you know, what are the transfers are, you know, they are receiving. So this is the entitlement, is the my definition of pattern of growth, that how people get entitlement to that, you know. So a composite measure of entitlement, I mean, you can measure entitlement in various ways, but a composite well-known measure of the entitlement is income. That when people, you know, when they are participating in the economy, they get access, they get income. And then they exchange that income and buy, you know, at market price, and they buy consumer goods, or goods and services, right? So the pattern of growth, the composite measure of pattern of growth is the income of an individual. So there are, supposing, millions of individuals, so you will have a vector of entitlement, you know, everybody's income, that will be included in that. So income can be derived from productive activities, such as labor market, they participate in labor market and then they derive income. They can have entrepreneurs activity, they have been running a business and, you know, and they invest and then they produce output, you know. So income can be derived from the productive sources, but there are also unproductive sources through which they derive income. For instance, interest payments, rental income, and transfer payments. Transfers may come from the government or other, you know, private individuals. So the sources of income are the wage and salary, other labor income, bonuses, proprietors, and rental income, dividends, interest, income transfer. So we try to capture the entitlement vector, entitlement people get through these income sources. Then through these income sources, people get entitlement. So this is a linkage I'm providing in defining the pattern of growth. So next, we move to the next slide. So supposing there are, you know, population consists of N people, which can be millions, you know. I mean, in China, it is 1.4 billion. India is almost a similar size. So capital N is the total population. So Y is the income of individual, IF individual. So we can describe the whole entitlement vector by this vector, it consists of income of every individual in the economy. So the entitlement of individual is determined by how the individual derive income from different sources. You know, that is the entitlement they. Now, this whole vector, it's too messy, you know, too many people, you know, the entitlement. So we can summarize into two factors. One is the mean income, you know, mean income. Why is not working? Anyway. Mean income, which measures the society's average standard of living, you know, mean income. And then there's a concept called Lorentz curve. Lorentz curve is the proportion of income enjoyed by bottom 2% of the population. Okay? So LP, Lagrange curve, is a relative measure to represent size distribution of income. You know, it's very widely used. It was the Lagrange who suggested this curve in 1905, as early as that. But I have a book called Inequality and Income Inequality and Poverty Methods of Estimation and Poverty, where I have extensively discussed this Lagrange curve. You know, it's a very powerful tool to describe size distribution of income. So what I'm saying is that these two factors, mu and LP, the Lagrange curve, they together describe the entitlement of all people in the economy. So these are the only two factors, and they describe the entitlement factor, you know. So I define pattern of growth by these two factors. These are jointly determined, you know. Average standard of living and LP, these are joint determinant of the growth process. I mean, the growth process is the total output that is produced, okay? And so simultaneous determination of mu and LP tells you the pattern of growth, okay? So this is a simple idea of pattern of growth. So now I come to the poverty. Now, an indicator of poverty, supposing, you know, I'm concerned with absolute poverty, where the poverty line is fixed, supposing Z is the poverty line. So mu is the mean income and LP Lagrange curve. So any poverty measure can be defined in terms of these three factors. Poverty line, which is fixed, exogenous, and then mu and LP. So which tells you that it is the pattern of growth which determines the poverty. You know, I mean, economists, many economists, they talk about, you know, economic growth, the linkage between poverty and reduction. But how output is produced, that's the one issue. And out of that output which is produced, our growth process, emerges this pattern of growth, and which determines the poverty. So pattern of growth is the main determinant of poverty, of social welfare, and any measure you talk about is determined by this pattern of growth. Okay? So pattern of growth matters in defining poverty, measuring poverty, making policies about poverty. So what I did, you know, so there are factors, you know, that question I was asking, I had a paper in 1993, where I was asking how poverty is determined, whether it is because of the mean income, or average standard of living, or is it because of the change in the distribution, okay? So I decomposed any poverty measure by two factors, growth effect. Growth effect is the effect of change in mean income on poverty when distribution remains constant, you know, keeping the distribution. This is like a counterfactual, you know, that supposing distribution had not changed, how much would be the change in poverty? And then redistribution effect, the effect of change in the distribution of poverty when mean income remains constant, you know, no growth. So this is the decomposition I proposed in 1993 and calculated many elasticities about that. Now, so based on this idea, my idea, the growth and redistribution effect, Bergen in 2004 introduced the idea of growth, inequality, and poverty triangle. You know, you must have heard about it, Bergen, you know, it's quite well known. You know, it's not published, paper is not published, it's a working paper, but it's quite well known, growth, inequality, and poverty triangle. But he, in discussing this triangle, so growth in poverty, he introduced the idea of growth elasticity of poverty and inequality elasticity of poverty. You know, he put it that way, you know, in a simple identity, you know. Actually, this idea I derived from my earlier work in 1993. So he could separate the impact of growth and distribution. And he made an important observation that he concluded a change in distribution matters. And it can slow down the reduction in poverty in some instances. Change in the distribution may even offset the favorable effect of growth on poverty. You know? So this was an important conclusion which he arrived at it, right? That distribution matters. But you know, there's a lot of there are no consensus. A lot of economists are talking about that, you know, there's a literature now, a lot of literature on cross-country regression models, regressions, that growth does not have much significant impact on inequality. I mean, that's it. You know, literature has been saying that, you know, Ravalians and many other people who have talked about that, you know, but cross-country regression, they don't give you any conclusive answer, you know. A lot of efforts have gone into cross-country regressions, but inconclusive answers, you know. So we cannot believe that inequality or change in distribution has no impact on poverty. And Bergin point out that it has impact, right? So what he did was he calculated the similar to my growth elasticity. He calculated, you know, elasticity with respect to mean income. But inequality elasticity, you know, the growth effect you can easily capture, you know, that Lorentz curve does not change, distribution does not change. How much is the impact on poverty due to change in the average standard of living, right? But when you come to inequality elasticity, is problem, you know? Because the longest curve is a curve, you know? It's not a single measure of inequality, right? So how do you calculate the inequality elasticity? You know, when whole curve is shifting up and down, you know, it can shift in infinite number of ways, right? So Bergin, what he did was, clever thing he did was that he assumed log normal distribution in formulating this. Now log normal distribution has only one distributional parameter, right? So it has a restriction that either whole Lorentz curve shifts upward or downward, whole Lorentz curve. But in practice, distribution can change in infinite number of ways. Some part of the Lorentz curve may go up, other parts of the Lorentz curve may go down, right? So you cannot obtain an analytical expression for the inequality effect. But he arrived at it because he assumed log normal distribution, right? So that is a problem, you know, in Bergin's analysis, right? Because log normal distribution is a very strong assumption. Yeah, it has a lot of restriction on the distribution. Distribution can change in many ways. So, you know, assuming that whole distribution changes, the whole Lorentz curve changes, is not, you know, practical, it's not realistic in practice. So what do I do here? You know, how to capture, you know, the pattern of growth. I go through the sources of income, which he didn't do. He was, you know, measuring the effect of distribution effect and growth effect. But I am going beyond that, you know, and looking at the sources of income. People, you know, derived. So supposing there are KM sources of income, you know, so GIX is the sum of income derived from IS source, and X is the total income an individual has. So X is the sum of the individual components, you know. So it can be labor income, it can be, you know, transfers, it can be, you know, agriculture income, and so on, you know. So what I do, I have extended the idea of growth and income and elasticity in terms of the changes in the mean incomes of the income components. So here, delta theta is the elasticity with respect to mean income or the total income, right? Then you can derive the effect of change in IS income component on the total poverty, which I call delta theta I, IS income, how it. So you can see that the total effect is sum of the individual income components income, which means that if all income components increase in the same proportion, right, then you should get the total effect of change in the mean income. So this is the idea here. Let me go further. So, okay. So I'm calculating this delta theta I, you know, for individual income component, you know, right? And then I can look at it, how individual component impacts the total poverty reduction in the total, you know? Then you can find out what is the contribution of wage income, what is the contribution of agriculture income, non-agricultural income, property income, and so on. Okay, so this is the basic idea of this paper, that I'm capturing these different effects through sources of income. Okay, you can interrupt me if any question, you know, if there is any question. Hmm? Now these are the different, you know, in case of China, these are the different components I'm using. So local wage income, because it's a rural China, so the local wage income includes local wage income earned by households, members, without migration experience, you know, because there's a migration taking place from rural to urban, right? So these are the wages which are earned in the rural sector, okay? And people haven't migrated, you know, who haven't migrated, they don't have a migration experience. And wage income includes both cash wage and in-kind income, because a lot of rural areas, there's in-kind, you know, wages are given in in-kind, and in agricultural particularly. And then migrant wage income, that people who have migrated to urban areas, right? They send remittances, you know, they have earning in urban areas, but they send remittances to rural areas. So that is that I call it as migrant wage income. Okay? And then even rural areas, it's not all agriculture. There are many activities that are taking place in the rural areas. So agricultural income includes business income from farming activities only, farming activities. And then there are non-agricultural activities that are taking place in the rural area, you know. So non-agricultural income includes business income from non-farming activities, okay. And then we have a property income. Net property income includes net interest income, rent plus dividends, you know. Dividends is also, we call it as property income, you know, okay. And then transfer income is a net transfer income that people get income, transfer income, but they also may be paying some taxes or making transfers to other households. So this is a net transfer, you know. Transfer income is a net transfer enjoyed by the rural households, okay? did do a little bit of analysis on this. Okay, it's not visible here. You know, it's visible here, but not here. Okay. Okay, so supposing gamma is the growth rate of mean income, our average standard of living. Now, and each income component is growing at a different rate. So gamma I is sort of a growth rate of ith income component. Okay? And SI is a share of ith income source, you know, share. So this is a relationship, you know, gamma is equal to the weighted average of the growth rates of the individual income components. I mean, this is very simple. So now here we see that, very interesting, that the total income, say 100%, you know, in 2007, 100%, and 24% of the income comes from labor income, 24%. And migrant wage income is 18.27%. You know? These are the remittances which are sent from the, you know, urban areas, the migrants who are migrated to urban areas. And agricultural income is about 38%, you know, 0.13. And non-agricultural income activities which are taking place is 11.4%. Property income is small, 3.19%. And transfer income, net transfer income is 4.97. So this is the sort of, but how it changes, you know, very interesting to see that wage income has increased substantially from share of wage income is 24% to about 41%, you know. So China's growth is the wage income which has increased so much, you know, that the growth rate of wage income is almost 31%, you know, 31% increase in the wage income. Migrant wage income has declined. You know, from 18% to 11%. I mean, you, if you are following Kuznets' hypothesis, Kuznets, right? I mean, there's a continuous migration from rural to urban areas. Then we should expect that migrant wage income should increase over when growth is taking place, but share is declining from 18% to, you know. So we investigated why it is happening, you know, I mean, when there's a structural transformation is taking place, the migrant income should increase. So what happened was that we looked at, there are two kinds of migration, you know. One is that people leave their families and go to urban areas. And another, so they transfer money to their families in the rural area. Second reason is that they take whole family to the urban area, then they don't transfer much, you know. Maybe the parents and all that, but they small transfers. So what we found is that Chinese economic growth is determined by the whole families moving to the urban areas. And that is why the share of migrant wage income has been declining. And that, you know, come out. But the most interesting thing is agricultural income. 38%, it has reduced to 22%, you know, to 23% is the agricultural income. So agricultural sector is declining in China very rapidly, you know. There's an article by Ravalian and Chen in Journal of Development Economics some time ago. They're talking about this agriculture is the main determinant of poverty reduction, or main determinant of growth in China. But it doesn't look like, you know. Agricultural sector is declining, you know, in terms of actually non-agricultural income is increasing from 11.4 to 12. You know, it's not too much increase, but it is increasing. But property income has gone up by 35%. You know, the people are investing in dividends and, you know, even the rural areas, and their rental income. And then transfer income has increased quite substantially, you know, from 4.97 to 7%. So almost 23%, 24% is a transfer income, which shows that China is not only having large economic growth, impressive economic growth, but they are also putting money in welfare programs. You know, they are putting a lot of money in their welfare programs, you know. So China is not just forgetting the people, you know, I mean, they are concentrating on people also, you know. So actually, maybe economic growth provides them an opportunity to invest in welfare programs, which they are doing, you know. So these are all the real, you know, real prices in 2013 prices based on the national average basket. You know? So we have made all the proper adjustments. So this is a, you know, sort of pattern of growth which comes out of China. Now, I want to characterize the pattern of growth in terms of the elasticities, you know. So as I pointed out, that elasticity of highest income source, this is a decomposition which I give, you know, that if any income source increases, supposing wage income increases or property income increases, it always increases the mean income, right? I mean, proportion may be different, but it always increases the mean income, right? So that is like an income effect, you know? But then there is a distribution effect. You know, the second term is the distribution effect, that how that different income components are redistributing income, you know, whether they are helping the poor or non-poor. So that is the second component, is the redistribution component. I mean, if you have done the consumer theory, demand theory, you know, there's a Slutsky equation, you know, very popular Slutsky equation, which says that substitution effect and income effect. Income effect and substitution effect. So income effect is similar to income effect here, but the substitution effect is like a distribution effect, right? I mean, substitution also depends on whether growth is, you know, commodity is elastic or inelastic. So similar idea comes here, you know, the Celestki equation, which is very well known in demand theory. So now the income effect, okay, when any component increases, the mean income increases, distribution does not change, therefore poverty should reduce. I mean, intuitively, poverty should always reduce. So the first component is always negative, okay? The second component can be negative or positive. If it is negative, that means that it is reducing the poverty. And if it is positive, it is increasing the poverty. So the propoorness of the growth is determined by the second component. If it is positive, it is anti-poor. If it is negative, it is pro-poor. So we can define a one indicator, phi I, which is the measure of pro-poor or anti-poor. If it is greater than one, then the second component is negative. Phi is greater than one, so it is pro-poor. And if phi is less than one, it is anti-poor. So this component will tell you which phi I will tell you which income component is pro-poor or anti-poor. Is the labor income, transfer income, you know? What is the impact on pro-poorness, you know? I mean, actually, these are the equations that define the, you know, pattern of growth. Okay. Now, so this was individual component, but if you add the contribution of each, you get a total poverty. So the total poverty reduction, percentage change in poverty, again, is given by two components. First component is the overall effect. First, we were calculating the individual income component, but now we have the overall. So overall effect is, first is the growth effect, another is the distribution effect. If you can see that if gamma I is equal to gamma, if all components are decreasing at the same rate, then distribution, there's no redistribution, right? So the second component is zero. But they, as we saw that, they increase at a different rate. The growth rate of each income component is different. So its impact on poverty reduction is different. So rho is some kind of overall measure of propoorness, overall, whole poverty, not the individual. Phi I was the individual, but this is the overall. So if rho is greater than one, the overall growth in China is propoor, otherwise is empirical. The important point I want to make here, that this poverty equivalent growth rate, I mean, rho only tells you whether growth is propoor or empirical. But it doesn't tell you how much is the impact of growth on poverty reduction. So I use the idea of poverty equivalent growth rate, which is a paper published in Review of Income and Wealth, where I'm asking that how much is the poverty reduction, is the growth rate that will result in the same proportional change in poverty as the present growth rate if growth process was not accompanied by change in the distribution. So using this idea, I get a sort of composite measure, which takes into account the average growth rate and also how propoor it is. So the poverty reduction depends on the average growth rate and how much propoor it is, propoor or antipoor it is. So gamma hat is the rho time, and which can be decomposed into growth rate plus the second term, rho minus one. So second term is the loss or gain in growth rate. If growth process, if pattern of growth is propoor, then there's a gain in growth rate. And if it is antipoor, it is loss in growth rate. So this is a basic idea of methodology. Now I move on to some illustrations. Okay. So these are the poverty elasticities that poverty gap is a poverty measure. Now, elasticity is minus 0.37. What does it mean? It means that if wage income increases by 1%, poverty reduction will be 0.37%. Okay? And if total mean income increases by 1%, then total impact on poverty will be 2.1%. So 2.1%, 2.1 is the sum of all the individual components. How much if there's a change, in the income component. Say migrant wage income is minus 0.34%, is less than, agriculture income is, has more impact on poverty, minus 1.11%. If 1% increase in agricultural income will reduce the poverty by 1.1%. So property income, you can see, is very low, minus 0.04. What does it mean? That if the increase in property income has no impact on poverty, very little impact on poverty, right? Whereas agricultural income has the highest income. Transfer income is higher. Transfer income is lower, 0.13. It's the agricultural income which has the, which is the most propoor. It will come out to be most propoor. Now, you can see here that, that wage income, the elasticity is 0.37, which means that 1% increase in wage, reduction in poverty is 0.37%. But if out of wage, 50% is the reduction due to growth effect, that if the distribution did not change, if you're a counterfactual, the distribution did not change, then poverty would have reduced by 0.50%. And actual reduction is only 0.37%, which means that 0.13% is due to change in the distribution, and which is increasing the poverty. So which means that wage income is anti-poor. You know, it's not pro-poor, you know, because it is contributing, the change in the distribution is contributing to increase in poverty, not reduction in poverty. Similarly, agriculture income, elasticity is minus 1.11, of which 80% was the growth effect. So which means that 0.31% was the redistribution effect, which is negative, which means that agricultural income is highly pro-poor. Okay? So this is intuitive. Similar interpretation can be given to these different elasticities. Okay? So now here I'll just present you the aggregate, you know, the pro-poor index. So you can see here, again, confirming that local wage income, propoor index is 0.74, which means that it's less than one, it's anti-poor, right? And if you look at migrant wage income, 0.88, again, it's anti-poor, you know? But agricultural income is highly propoor, 1.39. So agricultural income is the most propoor. Property income, the least pro-poor, is a very anti-poor, you know, 0.57, you know, much less than one. But transfer income, 1.26, is also very highly pro-poor, you know, where the government programs are, you know, playing the role there. Okay, so let's move on. Now then we look at how much is each component is contributing to poverty reduction. So you can see that all components, you know, poverty reduction gap, is, you know, total 18.23% is the poverty reduction. 18.23% is the poverty reduction of all the income components, and local wage income is 11.58%, you know? So which means that almost 64% of the poverty reduction comes from the wage income, you know? 64%, because 11.58 is the contribution of wage income, and 18.23 is the total effect. So 11 divided by 18, about 64% of the contribution is wage and salary. So why poverty is decreasing? Because there is a huge increase in wage income. Okay. Now agricultural income is interesting. Now out of that, you know, 18.23%. 24% is the growth effect and 6.34% is the distribution effect, which means that total growth is not pro-poor in China, is anti-poor, which means inequality is increasing, you know, in anti-poor, you know. But similarly, also the wage income, you know, the growth effect is 15.75, so the inequality effect is positive 4.17, so which is anti-poor. But agricultural income is pro-poor, non-agricultural, all other income components, but transfer income is pro-poor. Okay? So important point I want to make is that contribution of agriculture to poverty reduction in China is only 2.1%, which is very small, you know, which goes against what Gavalian and Chen were talking about, you know, that agriculture plays a very important role. I mean, agriculture is important in supporting the other sectors,
But itself, it is declining. Contribution of the agricultural income is declining. And non-agricultural income is increasing. We know a lot of activities are taking place, non-agricultural activities in the rural area, which might be generating more employment, right? And therefore, the higher wage income, you know? So that is very important here, that contribution of non-agricultural income is 8.8%, which is the larger component. And property income is also, you know, it's anti-poor, very anti-poor, but it's increasing such a rapid rate. It's increasing at such a rapid rate that it has an impact on the property. Some benefits, which are property income benefits going to the rich, they are trickling down to the poor, but not much, you know. But it has an impact on poverty reduction too. And transfer income is 17%, which is quite high, you know, that transfer income. The growth effect is only 2.48, but inequality effect is 0.65. So transfer income is highly pro-poor, and it is contributing to about 17% reduction in poverty, which means that China's economic growth is, you know, they are investing money in the social sector, and which is having impact. You know? And we'll come to that social sector. Now, property income, right, is increasing at the, you know, growth rate is 35%, right? Which means that the government has now can tax the property income, right, without affecting the poverty, So this is a conclusion that the government can utilize this opportunity to tax the property income more, you know, and then they can collect the revenue, put money in the social programs and so on. Okay. So this is the whole total pattern of growth. This is the total, you know, the pattern of growth, which is happening from 2007 and 13. Now, the government transfers, you know, what kind of government transfers are there? The pension, about pensions, DBAL, have you heard of DBAL? You know, that's the largest safety net program in China, you know. It covers almost 42% of the population, you know. 42 million population DBAL covers, providing safety net in the rural area, you know. How much is the coverage of PPP? About 20 million?
And 5 million households.
Yeah, so about population will be about 20 million, yeah. And China, it is about, you know, 15 million households and 42 million individuals, you know, who are beneficiaries of DBAL. So DBAL, you know, is contributing, you know, quite substantially, and it is highly propoor. You know, you can see the propoor index for DBAL is 7.08%, you know. Then there are other programs, subsidies, you know. They have a reimbursed medical expenditure, subsidies on agriculture. Subsidies on agriculture is a very large program, you know. Then transfer. So this is the total, you know, how the Chinese are contributing to social welfare programs. I give you the picture here, how much is the expenditure, you know. I mean, now I'm emphasizing that it is not just the program, it is reducing poverty and all that, but how much is the cost of the program, you know. That is very important, you know, that, you know, many evaluations, they don't consider the cost of the program. I have provided evaluation of Bolsa Familia and PPP, where I brought the cost of it. But cost is not readily available for Philippines, you know? So it's very difficult to make comparisons, but cost is very important. You know? I mean, that's the point I was raising in China too, that you know, if you look at the, you know, DBAO, they are spending 2015. They are spending almost 91 billion yuan in DBAO. You know, and I calculated that out of 91 billion, not 2013 will be about 86 billion. Out of 86 billion, how much is going to the beneficiaries? You know? Can you believe that it's 19.8 billion only? So I'm asking Chinese scholars, what is happening to that money? That almost 86 and 19, you know, almost 65 billion is disappearing, you know, as administrative cost. You know? Pretty expensive program, you know. I don't know. I mean, I'm not getting an answer from the scholars that, you know, I discussed with many people who are experts on that. But they, you know, what happens is that, you know, different money goes from, you know, federal government, provincial government, to the local governments, you know. I mean, so they are sending the money, but without, you know, monitoring how they are, you know, using that money. You know, maybe there's some money they are allocating under DBAO, but their local governments are spending on something else. You know, it may not be corruption, but maybe spending something else. We don't know. And I'm trying to get to the bottom of that, that such a big amount of money. Similarly, agricultural subsidies, you can see 170 billion, you know, they spent on 2013, and 74 billion is going to the actual beneficiaries, you know? So these are very expensive programs. You know, China can make huge, you know, I mean, rationalize these programs. Because what happened, the decentralization, that the local government, they have their own poverty line. I mean, so they don't have, you know, clubs, they don't have a capability to have a poverty line which is consistent, and they don't have a capability to do proper targeting. You know? So where we are suggesting is that central government should, you know, develop some kind of proxy means test, right? And then increase the capabilities of these local governments, how to run that proxy means testing, you know, and which may rationalize the program, you know. But you know, these programs are very costly, so that's a policy, you know, I'm suggesting to the Chinese, but I don't know how seriously they will take me, you know, on this. But so let me now just summarize what I have been talking about. Now, as I talked about poverty equal and growth rate, if it is not propoor, the inequality is increasing and then there's a loss of growth. So I did the calculations, the poverty equal and growth rate calculation. So 25% of the growth is lost in China because it is not propoor. 25% of the economic growth is lost. Hmm? I mean, which is quite substantial in my view, right? So saying that growth does not have impact on redistribution, the impact on poverty through redistribution is wrong, you know? I mean, there is a substantial impact on so that poverty equivalent growth rate tells you how much is the loss of growth rate. Now, agricultural income contributes only 2.1% to poverty reduction, as I pointed out, right? Why, even if it is highly propoor. Why it is? Because the agriculture sector is declining. You know, and non-agriculture sector is increasing, property income is increasing, so that's why agriculture sector is on decline. You know, it's not contributing too much to the poverty reduction because its contribution is very small. And property income is highly propoor, but it still has some impact, you know, because of through trickle down. You know? But then we are suggesting, I'm suggesting that property income can be taxed, because it is, they're highly anti-poor, only, you know, non-poor are benefiting from the property income. So they can easily tax it more and use that money to improve welfare programs. But they have to improve the efficiency of welfare programs, which is not efficient in terms of cost. Maybe in terms of poverty reduction, it is efficient, but not in the terms of cost. Cost is too high. The non-agricultural activities are increasing. I think they will continue increasing. And government transfers I talked about. But one important point I want to make is that wage income is becoming more anti-poor, which means that if this trend continues, then there's likelihood of more increase in inequality in China in the future. So they have to do something about it, because wage income is a major contributing factor to the poverty reduction. So these are some of the conclusions which I have drawn by using the pattern of growth. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the very informative and comprehensive presentation, Dr. Kakwani. So at this point, we invite everyone to participate in the open forum. May we request you to please state your name and your affiliation before asking the question, and kindly make them brief and clear. And we'll be taking 3 questions at a time to be answered by Dr. Kakwani. Yes, sir.
A government corporation affiliated with Land Bank. Now, I have three related questions. One would be, there was a reduction in the poverty. Is it because of the women's participation? Mao is a champion of women's rights. Number two would be, while your study was on 2013, let me go out of the box. This is in relation to the trade, the development of trade. China has increased tariffs in retaliation to to President Trump's increase in the tariffs in the aluminum and iron. Will this affect poverty reduction? The third one would be on WTO. A big, huge amount is given to subsidies. Is that in violation of the World Trade Organization rules? Thank you very much.
China, I found that gender issue is not that important in China. I think Philippines also, the women participate in growth process quite extensively in China as well as in Philippines. I don't see that gender is a big issue in these two countries. Maybe that we can work on that, but I haven't presented anything on how much would be the impact, how much is the gender gap in earning, and maybe which income component is contributing to the gap, reduction in gap. I mean, that will be interesting. I mean, it can be easily done. I haven't looked into that, but that can be done, and I think it would be very useful to do that, But I think what I guess is that I won't find very significant differences. Maybe, say migrant income, we were talking about that people leave the family and in the, you know, in rural area. But now the trend is that they have relaxed the migration, you know, HOKA system they have, you know, that they have to register in urban areas. You know, they have to have a HOKA, urban HOKA and rural HOKA, you know, they have, right? So I think they have relaxed those conditions. And that is why what is happening is that migrant income is declining, right? Because people are able to take their whole family and then they don't have to transfer money, you know? But the families who are left behind, where women can play a more important role, because if women are not migrating, men are migrating, they can play an important role. So I think, but that migrant income, that kind of migration is declining. So I don't know whether we can get a significant result out of that. Second question is about trade. China hasn't reacted yet, probably, against Trump. Huh? They haven't reacted that they are going to have a trade war and all that. I think Chinese are very careful about it. You know, they are not jumping up and down about that quickly. You know? Trump is jumping up and down, but Chinese are very thoughtful about it, and they don't want to just jump into it and have a trade war. But if they do have trade war, I would expect that maybe the China's economic growth will slow down. And that will have impact on poverty reduction. It may slow down. You know? We don't know yet, you know, how much will be the impact. And, you know, trade war, which commodities, you know, they put tariffs in on it. And you are saying the subsidies, you know, the welfare subsidies. I don't think they have anything to do with the trade much, you know. I mean, these are the welfare programs, you know. They should not have any, you know. You cannot say that they are violating the, you know, WTO norms. You know, they're not, you know. In the welfare programs, any country has a right to have welfare programs to look after their population, poorer population, you know. So these are the answers to your question. Yeah.
Good morning. I'm Akiko Terada Hagiwara, East Asia Department of Asian Development Bank. Very interesting presentation, thank you very much. I have three questions, all related, because we are actually looking at poverty reduction history of in China currently. And I understand your study looks at these chips for the years between 2007 and 2013. Yeah. I just wanted to know if there was any reason why you picked this period, because this is a very particular period, just the year before global financial crisis and few years afterwards. So the government had intervened a lot in the economy. So the finding you have may be affected by a lot of those things, and I wouldn't be very surprised if the growth was not really targeting any of the poverty reduction part. So that's first question. And number two is related to this. So what if we do the same exercise for the years in 80s and 90s? Well, you know, if you have any priors as to what we may be able to find, that would be very interesting too. Especially that 80s and 90s, government poverty reduction strategies were really on the economic growth first, big roads, big railways, you know, lifting the economy, overall economy first. But in 2000, my understanding is that government is really focusing on lifting up household households or individuals very specifically. So transfers make more contributions. I think it's consistent with what we may expect to happen. That's number two. And lastly, so even, having said that, I just want to know what your views on why growth in during this period has not really transmitted to redistribution. If there are other things that may be stopping that to happen, such as fiscal framework or any tax systems that they may have, and it's not really progressive in the country. So I just wanted to know your view on that.
About the period 2007, my whole methodology is based on income sources, right? And I could not, other years, I could not get a comparable data for different income sources. I can get the aggregates, but the methodology is based only on, income sources to capture different aspects of propoorness of growth. So that's the reason, And I think they introduced some reforms before 2007, and some after 2007. Actually, they introduced tax reforms. I think around 2006 or 7, they changed their tax rates and all that, the income tax rates. So actually some scholars, I talked to them in China, they are working on that what is the impact of these reforms, tax reforms? Are they helping the poor or non-poor? Are they progressive or non-progressive? Income tax rates are progressive or non-progressive? Actually, they are using Kakwani index, they have. They calculate Kakwani index before and after the reform, and they're coming out that reforms haven't been that good in terms of that. Your second question, whether why some component, propoorness, that's a very, there's no single answer that, that their fiscal policy or, income tax policy, because the whole growth process, the pattern of growth is very complex, very difficult to pinpoint what is causing, but we are looking at individual income sources, If for instance, we looked at the migrant income, that migration has, family, they have relaxed the, those requirements, so which will have impact on that. But wage and income, what is happening in China is non-agricultural activities are increasing in rural area, right? Which is having a good impact, I mean, the Chinese, through subsidies, they are giving agricultural subsidies and all that. Maybe the indirect effects are very strong in developing, not the agricultural sector itself, but activities in non-agricultural sector. The property income is anti-poor, that's well known everywhere, it is anti-poor, But it can have some impact because it's increasing very fast, very rapidly, and therefore my suggestion is that they can take this opportunity and increase, have more taxes on property income, which they can use to reduce poverty more through the social welfare programs. But social welfare programs are very expensive. That is my concern in China. And my another concern is that wage income, the trend is that inequality might increase. So they have to do something about that. Maybe ADB, can you note down that point, that in future, the might increase the inequality, you know, and wage is the important, most important component in poverty reduction. What is the third question?
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. May I just follow through on the HOKU system and its impact on labor income, migrant income, and transfers? Because your migrant income is affected by the time frame of your definition, which is half a year. Now, when they migrate, and they usually migrate and work there, for more than a year, it's covered under labor income, but they're still covered under the HOKU system. And there are too many restrictions which impact on their access to transfers. They could not access the transfers because of the restrictions, because that's part of the HOKU system. So what then is the impact of the HOKU system on your time frame for migrant income and versus the labor income and their access to transfers? Second, often.
Are there restrictions on transfer to the rural areas? They cannot transfer money, remittances?
No, because when they migrate to the big cities, their access to all those welfare, social services are restricted. They could not. So that's one. Second, offhand, if you apply the whole analysis to the Philippine case, what are your expectations of hand? And then third, because I'm interested, because there are already surveys on like the AIM's dynamism of the local economies. They consider that in the competitiveness of the local communities. But I think if that could play a role in terms of the labor income in the local communities, the impact of the dynamism of local communities, that will also impact on the results. Thank you very much. I'm with the Congressional Policy and Budget Research Department. I'm Manuel Aquino.
Thank you for your question. I mean, the HOKU system, yeah, that's true that maybe in the beginning, but they might lose some benefits, you know, when they migrate to urban areas, you know. But my understanding is that HOKU system, they are relaxing a lot. They have relaxed it, you know. I mean, there's a lot of debate in China about that, the relaxation, you know. So that's why the analysis is telling you that period from 2007 to 2013, there's a increase in family migration to the urban areas, you know. So they have relaxed it quite substantially, and that is why the migrant income is not becoming very important, you know. In context of Philippines, I was looking many years ago that the remittances, you know, the Philippine households, you know, the rural areas particularly, they get remittances from urban areas and remittances from overseas. So I found that remittances coming from overseas in Philippines, they are anti-poor. And remittances coming from urban areas, they are pro-poor in Philippines, you know. I mean, that was many few years ago I did it, but I didn't pursue it that much, you know. So that is the context, you know. The HOKU system, I don't understand that much how much relaxation and how much the access to the welfare programs they have in urban areas. I haven't studied the welfare programs in urban areas, you know, it's only in rural areas. But most of the programs are in rural areas, you know, the welfare programs, you know. Maybe the educational subsidies are important in urban areas, educational, you know. I find that higher education is highly subsidized in China. So these migrants may not have access to higher education in urban areas, you know. I mean, I was in the university, you know, the top universities and all that, and they are the very elite, you know,
people who go to the university there, you know, university there. But they are subsidizing very heavily people in the university. You know, in the university I saw that, you know, many students, they hardly pay any tuition fees, or they get money from the government to live, you know. So there's a high, lot of subsidies in education area. China is investing a lot. I don't know Philippines, how much they are investing in education, you know, that is the critical in China. I think the growth may be due to investment in education, you know. Hmm? I mean, that is what I found in Brazilian case, you know, if you read my book, you know, Brazil, that they increase the, expanded the education system in Brazil, which was very propoor, highly propoor. And that was the reason I'm saying that they reduced their inequality because of their, you know, expansion of the education, you know. So it's important comparison with Philippines, you know. It's important to do it.
So, sir, thank you very much for any other questions from the room?
Yeah.
Yes.
First of all, let me greet my friend Celia for being appointed as president of PIDS. I recall that William Sod was, I think, the first head of DGM who comes from the Women's Center. So it's been 30 years. Is that 30 years ago? More than 30 years ago. Anyway, I have three questions, Dr. Kakwani. First, can you help me understand better the second line and the last line? Because the second line talks about labor income being anti-poor, despite the fact that its contribution is 63%, and then the last line is.
Yeah,
says that.
That's bothering to you, right?
Okay, can you explain that a little
further?
Yeah,
okay.
Second, in the equation that you introduced, is it possible to bring in the demographic variable? Because that's a very important element in Philippine.
You mean household composition?
Demographic.
Household, aging, and.
No, I think it has more to do with population. Household size.
Household size.
Okay. And then the third is, can you comment on what is the likely income distribution effect of current Philippine policies or changes in the economic structure? Increase share of services, large OFW remittances, minimum wage. I don't know to what extent we can bring that as important elements in the analysis of poverty reduction.
Okay, now, I presented this in conference in China, Peking University. So they are also puzzled that, you know, finances, second line, the labor income is anti-poor, right? Right? But it has a huge impact on poverty reduction. Right? So it is not the, you know, pro-poorness is important, but it is also how much it is, you know, the level of, you know, if level is very high, for instance, you can have a program, social program, you know, say for Brazil, Bolsa Familia, is a very popular program, you know. But their expenditure, or income contribution to the people is about, you know, 0.4% of GDP, right? So it may be highly pro-poor, but its impact on inequality or poverty will be very small. Poverty may be high, but inequality will be very small. So this is what is happening here, that the labor income is increasing almost, 11% a year.
average standard of living due to wage income. It offsets the, you know, impact of the anti-poorness, you know. It offsets more than, you know, so much more that impact on poverty reduction is very high, right? But for instance, agriculture income is highly propoor, but it's declining. You know, the agricultural sector is declining, right? So the impact will be very, very small, you know, of agriculture sector, you know. So it will be the wage income will be the most important in poverty reduction in future. And my fear is that wage income might become more unequal, become even more anti-poor, you know, and which will have impact on inequality. What about the other question? Philippines, huh?
Demographic
variable. Yeah, that's a very interesting. I didn't go into the size of the family. You know, I mean, I've adjusted the per capita, everything I've done per capita basis. But does the size of the household matter? That's what your question is. No, I haven't looked at it to that. Maybe it's possible to look at it, you know. That household size may be. Maybe, you know, household size may contribute to more poverty reduction than, you know, it doesn't have to be that, you know, doesn't have to be. But they have a, they are concerned, Chinese are concerned, because they had a one child policy. So, you know, the population is aging there, you know. So that may slow down the growth in future. Because aging, Japan is happening, you know. I mean, Japan is, you know, they didn't have any growth, much of the growth since 1990, you know. Almost two decades of the growth. Because population is aging, their productivity is low, you know. So I think China is now relaxing their policy of one child policy, is gone now. You know? They are concerned about the aging of the population. You know? So, Philippines, I don't know. Is it population growth is very high in Philippines compared to other countries in the region, right? It is slowing down now. Yeah? 1.8, right? Yeah. I mean, other countries is much lower, right, in the region, you know. So, I mean, that's an important point to look at it, discuss it. But population growth does have an impact on, you know, poverty reduction. One way population, if total output is fixed, then any increase in population will reduce the standard of living. But point is that population growth also provides labor force, you know, right? Which may increase the output. So it's not very clear cut, you know, how much is the impact on that. I mean, olden days, I remember in India, they were talking about, you know, the population is increasing so much that they were very concerned, and they were providing incentives to people in terms of transistor, not to have children, you know, so they'll provide a transistor and, you know, things like that. But that thinking is gone now in India. I mean, I know the population was lower when I was growing up in Delhi, you know. We were struggling with the food and all that, you know. We were poor. But now, when I went to India, the lavish amount of, you know, money they are spending, on lavish consumption of food is so much high now than it used to be when population was very low. So the thinking is, you know, going away. Maybe here the population is growing faster than the other countries. That may be good. I don't know.
The third question.
Good morning, Professor. I'm sorry, you're asleep. I'm a fellow of the European Institute for Development Studies.
Oh, okay.
And And in the context of China, the way I understood it is the growth of China and the poverty reduction in the long run more or less started when they actually had reformed their land tenure system, the property rights. And so, in other words, the property income would have changed, and the tenurial system had in effect stimulated or allowed for growth to happen, entrepreneurship, etc. So in other words, directly or indirectly, it has contributed to sustained growth and reduction in poverty. So could you kindly explain why you're saying that it is anti-poor?
Property income comes out to be highly anti-poor, anti-poor. I mean, which is intuitive, you know, because of property income, you know, the dividends, share, you know, the coming from dividends and rental income and interest and all that, you know, right? Those entitlements go to the rich. So it's not surprising that it is anti-poor. But the surprising thing is that the growth in property income is so large in China, you know, even in rural China. I mean, I was very surprised that why doing, maybe what you are pointing out that, you know, the since the reform, they made reforms into land entitlement and all that, that might be contributing to rapid growth in property income. That might be an important contribution. Maybe we should point out in the paper. Haven't pointed out, you know. But the fact is that even if the growth in property income is 35% per annum, right? That's a huge growth. If little of that trickles down to the poor, right? It can have a large impact on poverty reduction. You know. So that is the point, you know, that I'm making, that it is not only the propoorness of anti, the propoorness I define as the poor proportionally get more benefits, not absolute, from the growth. If poor benefit proportionally more than the rich, then it is.
That's strongly propoor.
No, it's propoor. It's strongly propoor is that absolute benefit going to the poor is higher than the going to the rich. That is the strongest. That is the strongest definition of propoor, that absolute benefit. But the proportional benefit, poor have a smaller income, so proportional benefit, so it's weaker condition actually. So the propoorness here I'm talking about is a weaker requirement, you know, not a stronger. But if I had said absolute terms, right, then the story would be consistent with what you are saying, you know, you are surprised that buying property income is reducing poverty so much, you know, because absolute and there is a distinction between absolute and relative definition of growth.
Can I follow up?
No, I think because one has to be careful in my view in terms of the nuances and the labeling, because and also that when you say in effect the implication is, you know, basically if you want to have reduction in poverty, you have to do something about poverty income, as if you need to reduce poverty income. But the impact of that would very much depend on the instruments that you will be using. So if you go back to tenure land reform again, it could actually have an anti-poor. You might not have the kinds of implications that you are thinking in terms of the policy conclusions.
I mean, anti-poor does not mean that it has no impact on poverty reduction. Let me be clear about that. Yeah. You know? I mean, anti-poor means that poor are proportionally getting less than the rich. That's the only requirement. So anti-poor does not mean, but it depends on the level also, you know? Level, you know. So that's why, you know, that power. exponential growth rate, which I am talking about, is a product of the two, you know, that growth rate, you know, multiplied by the propoor. So if growth rate is small, you know, the impact on poverty will be small. If growth rate is large, with a given propoorness, impact will be larger. So the poverty equivalent growth rate tells the story, you know. Okay? And I found that because growth is anti-poor, there's a loss of growth rate of about 25%. You know, would have been higher, you know, if China had pro-poor growth. So actually, they have a lot of scope now. They can improve their growth rate, making more pro-poor. So they can even achieve much larger poverty reduction than they are at the moment achieving. I mean, achievement is very large now at the moment, but it could be even higher. And they're also spending a lot of money on social programs and all that. So China is not just relying on growth, you know, alone. They are spending money on education to promote growth, and at the same time, they are also, putting money in social. You know, I showed you many welfare programs they have, you know. So
first, on the, when you mentioned that between urban remittance and the OFW or overseas remittance get to be less proof, right? Is that correct? For the case of the Philippines, yes, that one. I want to clarify that. Then second, when you look at agriculture, and its declining contribution to poverty reduction. Were you able to isolate the type of crops or type of agricultural activities that the Chinese are doing, which you can learn from? So I was just interested, because we're so dependent on certain types of crops also. And then another clarification is, I think it was mentioned already that they are investing on education, and you said tertiary or higher level education. Can you elaborate further on the share of that investment relative to the total transfers? Thank you.
I don't know. I mean, I was new to China. I started work last year, but what I see, I was visiting the university, Beijing Urban University and other universities. Huh? So the amount of money they are spending on higher education is amazing. If you go to any university campus, you'll find a huge, you know, beautiful infrastructure. The students are living in dormitory, you know, all of them, you know, and they provide subsidized canteen and to the students, you know. So they're getting a lot of benefits, the students are getting in higher education. Chinese believe that the higher education is a possible economic growth. And they may be right about that. Right? So education they are spending. At the same time also they are spending on safety net programs, rebound, agricultural subsidies, you know. So I mean, for instance, you know, America, they are cutting down on that. Welfare programs, you know, they're cutting down. Trump doesn't like them. So that will have long-term impact, but China is wise in their policy. About the pattern of cropping and all that, huh? I mean, I wouldn't know much about that, you know, that's what is, you know, I mean, my all the analysis is based on what the data they collect. And I don't
know.
Yeah. I cannot make any comment on that. Philippines, I looked at you know, a few years ago, I don't know, Celia will know more about that. That I found that remittances from overseas, they go to the richer households. Maybe that richer households, you know, are middle class households, they go to overseas, you know, and then they send money to their family, you know. Where the rural areas migration, which comes to the urban area, they are not rich families, you know, and they transfer money, when they transfer money to rural areas, they're, you know, that's propoor. So, yeah, but that does not mean that, I mean, don't misunderstand me, you know, that does not mean that if it is anti-poor, it has no impact on poverty, you know, I mean, it has impact, depending on the level, you know, how much is the level. So poverty equivalent growth rate is a multiplication of the level of growth and
proportionate,
you know, so these are the two factors, not one factor. So maybe somebody should work more PIDS on remittances, you know, that would be very useful to work on that. And this methodology which I'm talking about, data are available in Philippines, very readily available, you know. You have, what is that, PIDS and what the other one, poverty. Yeah, EDSA, all the, you know, even more details than China I could find, you know. So you can apply this analysis very readily and, you know, you can draw many policy conclusions, you know. And maybe you can also relate to CBMS. You can provide a linkage with that, you know.
Are there any questions?
Good morning, sir. Yes, sir, I'm from the Commission on Higher Education. About the policy, the last bullet of your, you know, I'm just wondering if, because 70% is relatively big number percent. 70% of the proper current transfer contributing to poverty reduction. Now, I heard earlier from your report that it is not run very efficiently because from the higher government down to the smallest local government, it may not have reached or given to the targeted fisheries. But it could be recourse to other more productive economic activities or projects. Now, my first question is, would that 17% be increased in if the program is aware of, if that transfers were run very efficiently? Number two is, the quote-unquote are not run very efficiently, is that still efficiently, without very?
My point here is that, these social programs, they are having impact on poverty, no doubt about that, you know? Because when you give money to the people, they, you know, there's a reduction in poverty, you know? I mean, that's not surprising, you know? And they are pro-poor also, the programs are pro-poor. But my question, my objection is that the amount of money government is putting money in these programs is so large, right? That they are very inefficient, you know, at the moment. You know, the way they distribute the money to rural areas, you know, to the local government and all that, not very efficient to reduce poverty. So there's a need to make it more efficient, you know, because so much money which is going on, that can be used in other programs, other sources, you know, right? Which can be more beneficial, you know. So that is the point I'm making, that cost is very important. I mean, when you are talking about PPP, if you don't look at the cost, you know, it reduces poverty. Oh, so you can
feel complacent about that, but then you have to look at the cost of the program. Maybe that cost, when you set up a program in the beginning, cost is very high because you are setting up the infrastructure. But then over a period of time, how fast is cost reducing, you know? So you should calculate. I talked about the idea of social rate of return, you know, that how much program is increasing the social welfare and compared to the cost, that every dollar you spend, right, if program is contributing $1.30, you know, then to the welfare, then 30% is the rate of return, social rate of return. So you should look at the social rate of return. So that's why I'm emphasizing that all the evaluations which I have seen of the program, they only talk about the total benefits, but not the cost. So that is the idea I'm, you know, trying to sell, social rate of return.
The formula that you presented about looking at growth vis-a-vis distribution of the income of the growth to see the income of the impact on poverty reduction. And from the National Thai Poverty Commission with the basic sector of NAPSI. And I'm very interested to understand very clearly what you mean about your last two bullets in your policy conclusions?
This one?
Yes, your last two bullets, yes.
That was non-agricultural activities?
Yes. Given your definition that the non-agricultural activities are outside farming activities. These are business income from non-farm activities. Your definition of the transfers.
I mean, the point is that what is the agriculture, you know, I mean, they are giving agricultural subsidies. Is that a good idea to give agricultural subsidies and promote agriculture? Huh? I mean, same time, you can use that money to put in infrastructure in the rural areas, so that non-farm activities are increasing. So I'm talking about non-agricultural activities and non-farm activities, which can have large impact, you know, on I mean, it's not propoor, but still it can have a large impact on poverty reduction because you are increasing the activities in the rural area, you know. So that is very important. And again, the government transfers, right? Here also, the problem is cost again, you know, that the government transfers are effective, they are pro-poor, they are reducing poverty, right? But at a huge cost. So you can utilize that money, you know, there's huge inefficiency in the running of the program. You can utilize that money to increase the growth, or you can make other programs more pro-poor, you know. So that's the point I'm making, that cost is very important, you know. Okay.
Any more questions? Okay. Yes, sir.
I talked about local dynamism, local community dynamism a while ago, and its impact on labor income. Now, my point is, however, even if the local communities become dynamic and businesses are there, the businesses are restricted when owned by politicians and the local rich. So if you're talking about relative, in the case of the Philippines, if you're talking about relative poor to the impact on the rich, the would come out still anti-poor. Now, there are moves to federalize in the Philippines. What would your possible thinking on that matter in regard to the local community's dynamism and its impact on labor income? Thank you very much.
I think, I mean, local dynamism you're talking about, you know, that, you know, local communities. I mean, point I'm making is that maybe the local communities, should they focus on increasing the agriculture income or non-agriculture income? I mean, if the communities are dynamic and all that, right, then non-agricultural activities will be more, you know, profitable to increase, you know, because then there will be employment and more, you know, activities will be generated. But agricultural, you cannot generate those activities very fast, you know, in agricultural area. But non-agricultural, yes, you can, you know, government can provide incentives to communities to start their own enterprises and gender issues, the women can, you know, run the businesses, you know. When there's a migration, you know, men have gone, so women can start their enterprises in a local community, you know, in the rural area. So that is the dynamism you are talking about, you know. But that should be only in non-farm activities. You know, it will be non-farm activities will be more beneficial than the agriculture. Agriculture reaches the, you know, productivity. You cannot increase too fast in agriculture. Other activities you can, you know? That's what you meant, right? Dynamism, right? I mean, agricultural sector has limitations. You cannot increase the productivity. They can provide, it plays an important role in providing the food and all that, yeah? But does not play much role in increasing economic growth.
Good morning. I'm Lourdes Mendoza. I'm with the House of Representatives. During, in one of our committee meetings, I'm with the Committee on Poverty and Innovation, former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, whose administration started the conditional cash transfer program in the Philippines, said that 4Ps, Pantawid Pamilya Pilipina program, is not a poverty reduction program. We were all surprised because for many years, proposals in Congress tried to institutionalize the program as a poverty reduction program. Throughout your presentation, I kept on listening to how you look at the government transfers, and you even concluded they are highly pro-poor. Your last conclusion may even be applicable in the Philippines. The government transfers are highly pro-poor, and then you said, and contributing 70% to poverty reduction. Because of the never-ending debate in Congress, may I ask for your perspective as to whether or not it is proper to look at transfers as a mechanism to poverty reduction, considering that the first president of the Philippines that implemented the program said it is not a poverty reduction program. Thank you.
I think I made a comparison of PPP program with the Bolsa Familia. I found that the cost of running the program, you know, per beneficiary, the dollar going to any beneficiary, is higher in the Philippines than in Bolsa Familia. So, I mean, they have a set up an infrastructure in Philippines, in Brazil. You know, they have been running this program for 15 years, 10, maybe 12, 13 years, you know. So they have a good infrastructure, you know, how they transfer the money. You know, the ATM machine, they give them a credit card and then they can draw their benefits from the ATM machine, you know, in Brazil. You know? So maybe that, and where here, they try to replicate Bolsa Familia rather fast, very quickly. You know, that was my observation that, and that will increase the cost of the
the program, you know. So maybe that you have to slow down the program, you know, not fast, because you are learning over time, you know, and then you are making the improvement and improving the targeting and all that, you know. So that is important. That's why maybe that the perception is that, you know, PPP program is not poverty reduction. It does reduce the poverty. I mean, it cannot, you know, cannot say it doesn't. But how much poverty is the reduction compared to the cost of the program? That is what I'm trying to sell, the idea of social rate of return by each program, you know? I mean, I've discussed this in my book in details, you know, what is social rate of return, you know? So maybe that is an indicator you can use to calculate the social rate of return. So cost is important, that's what. It's not only the poverty reduction, but at what cost, you know? I mean, Chinese are not doing very well in that respect, you know? I mean, how can, you know, 86 billion they are spending and the people are getting only 19 billion, you know? Where is the money going? You know, I mean, you cannot say that that's a very good program, you know? The book is Social Welfare Functions and Development. Maybe I write it down for you. Development, Measurement and Policy Applications. It's published by Palgrave Macmillan. Celia, you know about it. So if you can circulate the title of the book to everybody. Incidentally, the book is reviewed in some journal recently.
I so there you go, Dr. Kakwani. So, one last question.
I'm asking the question because just like we are under time, we devoted 3 hours for this session. Anyway, just a small question, Professor. In the Philippine context, we have at the NEDA, and until now, there is a special committee looking at the rate of return of projects. And yes, and then in the context of the present government's program to build more infrastructure, they have reduced the hurdle rate for the rate of return of projects. I think from what I am familiar with, which is about 15, to as low as 10%. And one of the simple arguments, although perhaps a little more complex than this, is that even if that rate of return hurdle was reduced, it's still higher than the, I think it's about 10%. 10 or 12, it used to be 15.
ADB uses 12%,
right? ADB. Yeah, on the project, the minimum is 12%. Now, that point was as relevance with respect to what projects to endorse. And then it comes at a time when there are a lot of questions with respect to the fact that even some ODA loans are expensive. We're looking here at China. I think the Chinese have the most expensive rates. And I don't know what is the rate of the Asian Infrastructure Bank, would you know? The cost of. Anyway, the point being made by some policymakers is that even if we have reduced it 10%, it's still higher than the most expensive ODA rate. Would you like to comment on that, especially with respect to the margin of error that one can put on the estimation of social rate of return?
I think the ADB is 12% is some kind, you know, rate of return they use for
know, approximately, you know. I mean, there's no theory about it, you know, that how much it depends on the local interest rates, you know, and all that. There's no definite, but I'm not talking about physical, you know. I mean, you in a project, you invest money, right? And then you look at the how much is the return coming from the project, right?
Yeah, project.
But I'm saying that if, for instance, ADB wants to promote inclusive growth, then they should also look at inequality and poverty. You know that how much the project is having impact on inequality and poverty. And that is where my idea of social data return comes, you know, that it is the, you know, maximize the social welfare function, right, rather than just the income, you know, or just the output, you know, which is produced by the project. So that is what I'm, you know, in my book I have discussed that, that social welfare, so ADB should go for that kind of, you know, social rate of return. I mean, you cannot compare with a physical rate of return, the comparison is not relevant, because social rate of return can be very high, you know. I mean, if, for instance, if you have a project where only poor are benefiting, then social rate of return will be very high. You know, if non-poor are benefiting, then social rate of return will be very low. So that is what I'm, you know, selling my idea of social rate of return, which I hope ADB can adopt.
What is the range of discount rates which are being used by different parties?
Oh, I don't do the discount rate, you know, because, you know, the projects, they project future, right?
Yes.
The future incomes coming, you know, from the projects. Huh? What I'm talking about is that, you know, when you are talking about inequality and poverty, we do not go to the future, you know.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, we are interested in current, short term, you know, short term analysis. Not in the future, you know. I mean, the future we don't know. And you can have a discounting rate, and it's so ad hoc, you know, so discounting rate, you know, and different people use different discounting rate, you know. So this is the short term, you know, the social rate of return is the short term when you have a program. Maybe every year you can calculate, you know, you can revise your, you know. Social data return, you can look at it every year. If over a period of time, if social data return is has an increasing trend, right, then it's very good, you know. If it is a decreasing trend, then you know, you can look at it again, you know.
For the last question, Dr.
Talks and comments are really very provocative, and it is provoking me. and this is, I would like to ask your views about this, because you said you have to look at both the growth, the poverty reduction itself, and the inequality. And you know, in Vietnam, after they liberalized, mm-hmm. income inequality grew, right? But the poverty reduction rate has really come down dramatically. So, and then there is this literature about not all inequality are created equal. Meaning to say, not all inequalities are created equal. Meaning, there are good inequalities and bad inequalities.
Okay. That's a World Bank.
No, it's not just a World Bank thing. There's such a thing. Preparedness, I was taught when I was taking my in the undergrad, fairness is not the same as inequality or equality. And so when I, just to illustrate, there are certain inequalities that actually are almost necessary in order to create in
incentives for entrepreneurship, for growth, for innovations, etc. That's I think some people call it, those are kind of, in a sense, good inequalities. From hard work, you know, your income that you generate from your own hard work and innovations, etc. Society wants to be encouraged, that's what it's meant to be. So, there may be a point, don't you think, that there may be a point where sometimes when you reform something, you're around for inequality, but because that also brings about the incentives to be creative, to push hard, to really exert the effort, right? So, in a sense, policy makers might actually favor at a certain stage, particularly when they're still very poor and they're very little to share the pie. The pie is not small enough. Even you, when you share, you're just sharing in poverty. So wouldn't it make sense to actually kind of create the bigger the pie first? So can you comment on that view against your social welfare kind of manipulation?
When I said World Bank, you know, the 2006 World Bank brought out a report on equity of opportunities. You know, if you must have heard about that report, you know. So there, World Bank is arguing that there are two kinds of inequalities. One which is caused by family circumstances, and another that is caused by the efforts, you know. I mean, family circumstances that if your, you know, father's income is high, father's education, mother's education, you know, these are the family circumstances. That inequality is bad, not tolerable. But if it is efforts, you know, that if you put a lot of efforts and your income increases so much, that inequality is good, you know, because it increases the productivity of the economy and, you know, growth and all that, you know. So effort, you know, is good, you know. So I have a great objection to that kind of, you know, inequality, the family circumstances and all that, you know, the inequality cause. For instance, you know, it's not clear cut that what is family circumstances and what is effort inequality. You know, you cannot clearly define, you know. For instance, you know, I tell you that supposing a mother tells children bedtime stories, right? And the child does it very well over life because of listening to those stories, right? And it increases the inequality, right? Because he has heard those stories. So to conclude it, it would be, we can say that bedtime stories are bad for inequality, you know? You see the point. So that I don't agree with the World Bank. You know, the World Bank is saying, because the evidence says that family circumstances, you know, inequality is about 20%, right? So which means that World Bank will say only to focus on 20% of the inequality and ignore 80% of the inequality. You know, I don't agree with that, you know. But apart from that, your point is, I think, different. Yeah, your point is that
create the incentive, make certain result concomitantly with creating the incentive.
Yeah.
You suppress them, you're going to have.
I mean, there's a literature which I have reviewed, that literature. There's a lot of literature on that. Is inequality bad for growth or good for growth? You know, higher inequality, you know, promotes investments and all that, and it promotes growth. But now, thinking is also there that low inequality also is better for the growth than the high inequality, you know, initial inequality. You know. So this issue is not resolved, you know, right? Okay, my view about it, that there's a trade-off. Supposing China has reduced poverty so much, but this inequality is going up, right? So what should we do? I mean, how much we tolerate increase in inequality, and how much we, you know, give weight to the reduction in poverty, you know? So these are the two factors, right? So I would say that if reduction in poverty is very increase in inequality is very small, I would go for that policy. Right? I mean, you have to look at the trade-off. I mean, there's a value judgment. I mean, I can't give you clear-cut answer, but there's a value judgment that you make a judgment, say inclusive growth, ADB was promoting inclusive growth. So I would say that okay, inclusive growth, I mean, ADB came out that any increase in inequality is not inclusive growth, you know? But I would say yes, if poverty reduction is so much higher and increase in inequality is very small, I would call it inclusive growth, you know? So this is a trade-off, you know, you have to, you know, I mean, I can't give you clear-cut answer, there's no clear-cut answer for that.
Shouldn't the primary focus to get people out of their difficulties and hardships, not having enough food to eat?
Yeah, that is one view. I think I would agree with you that if poverty reduction is so much higher, if you know, if so many people are coming out of the extreme poverty, then we should give greater weight to that. And even if the inequality increases by a small amount, unless inequality increases by such a large amount, right? Like in America, they are talking about 1% against 99%, you know? That 1% is benefiting all from the growth, then 99%. Then it's a different, you know, ball game, you know? So it depends on the magnitudes and judgment. Answer your question.
Yeah.
Okay. So that concludes our activity this morning. Thank you, Dr. Kakwani, for your insightful presentation. We hope to have you again, and of course, to the active participation of our audiences. Thank you very much. See you in our future activities. Good afternoon. Good morning.